We have I Am Jack's heart monitor right here, so Mike Ryan will be speaking to you, so please welcome him to the stage.
Thank you. All right, good morning. Let me get this out of the way. Hi, I'm Mike Ryan, here to talk to you about Bluetooth Low Energy. Got a lot to cover, so let's just get right into it. The format of my talk, I'll just tell you a little bit about what low energy actually is, and then I'll tell you how we sniff it and give you a little demo of that. And finally, we'll talk about the security of the system. So what is Bluetooth Low Energy? It was introduced in the Bluetooth 4.0 spec that came out last year. It's also known as Bluetooth Smart. It's almost completely different from classic Bluetooth from a technical implementation perspective, but philosophically and use case wise, it's actually pretty similar. The main difference is, from a design perspective, it's designed to operate for a long time off of a coin cell battery, just a very low power source. So it's used, well, the spec's only been out for a year, so it's not used too many places. So far, I've seen it mainly used in sports devices, like the heart monitor that I'm wearing right now, and pedal cadence, things like that. I've seen a few sensors out there. Some interesting devices that I've seen coming out soon, a wireless door lock and a couple health devices, medical devices that I'll get back to in a little bit. And how does it compare to classic Bluetooth? Well, like I said, it's philosophically similar but technically very different. It still uses a master-slave architecture. You still pair in order to establish a secure connection between the devices, but beyond that, it's quite a bit different. It uses different modulation, still uses the same chunk of the spectrum, but it breaks it up into different channels, uses a different channel hopping scheme. It's actually quite a bit simpler. Different packet format, different whitening, quite a bit different from technical perspective, but still philosophically very similar to Bluetooth. So let's get on to sniffing it. As Mike Osman has told us many, many times, sniffing Bluetooth is hard. And we've made significant strides in this arena, thanks in large part to Bluetooth and some other devices out there, but it's still hard. Fortunately for us, sniffing Bluetooth low energy is slightly less hard. So how do we sniff it? Basically, we start at the bottom and work our way up. This is a Bluetooth protocol stack, similar to one you might see for an IP packet on Ethernet or something like that. I only really have time to talk about the phi layer and the link layer, but so let's talk about those a little bit. So what does the phi layer look like? So if you have a Bluetooth low energy device and it sends a packet, it uses a radio chip and actually emits some RF. And that RF is modulated using GFSK at a certain rate, 1 megabit I believe. It's on one of 40 channels. There's 1 megahertz wide, spaced 2 megahertz apart. So on Ubertooth, all the details of this are handled by the CC2400 radio chip. We just configure it and it does all the work for us. So what that does is it takes a chunk of RF and it gives us bits, which is good. So now we have bits. So let's move up to the link layer. This is right out of the spec. This is what a link layer packet looks like. We have just a couple fields, but you'll notice that they're all defined in terms of octets. We don't have octets, we have bits. So how do we go from bits to octets? Well, we want the start of the PDU. That's where the actual protocol data is, it's protocol data unit. We know the access address though. You can think of that as a connection specific address. And just assume for now that we know it. So what we do is we search through this stream of bits that's coming off the radio chip, and we look for this 32-bit value. And once we found the 32-bit value, it's most likely the start of our packet. So from that, we know where the start of the access address is and the octet boundary. We move forward 32 bits, and that gives us the start of the PDU. So from there, we have something that looks like this. This is a Bluetooth low energy packet as output by an Ubertooth. What does this mean? How do we interpret it? We read the manual. Seriously, it's actually a pretty readable manual. So I won't go into too many details about this, but this is how that packet actually breaks down practically. As you can see, there's a bunch of headers and so forth. And finally, we get to the meat of the packet at the bottom. This is a heart rate packet. Great. So what we have now is we can turn RF into packets. We can get these packets from an Ubertooth. I actually captured this off of my heart monitor while it was running. So what do we do now? Let's follow connections. So the way a Bluetooth low energy connection works is there are 37 data channels, and the master and the slave each hop along the 37 data channels according to a hopping pattern. It's a very straightforward pattern. You just add a fixed value to the current channel you're on to find the next channel. And the master and the slave each transmit one packet per time slot. So that's nice. It's a lot less complicated than classic Bluetooth, for those of you who are familiar with that. So these are actually the four values that you need to know in order to sniff a connection. The access address, the 32-bit value that sort of defines the connection, the CRC in it, which allows you to filter out false positive packets, and it filters out some packets that might have had a bit flip, but it just makes our life easier to have this. The time slot length, this is the amount of time we sit on a channel before hopping to the next channel. This is very important. And also the hop increment. If we're on a given channel, we need to know where the next channel is, so the hop increment is how we find that value. So armed with these four values, we can follow any Bluetooth low energy connection, much simpler than classic Bluetooth. So where do these values come from? Well, the easy way to get these values is if you observe a connect packet. They're just sitting right there in the wire. But that's cool, and yeah, if we sit around long enough, maybe we'll see a packet, or maybe we'll see a master initiated connection with a slave. But let's assume that we can't see that. Let's assume that that happens some other time, and we're just coming. We want to sniff a connection that's already established. Well, we have to get a little clever. So how do we find an access address? This one's pretty easy. We sit on a channel and we wait for empty data packets. They have a very predictable pattern. You can see it in green here on this packet, on this slide. It's just one followed by a sequence of zeros. Note that I'm not including whitening in this. Ask me about it later if you're interested. So we sit here and we watch this stream of bits coming in, and we look for this 16-bit pattern. And once we find it, we backtrack 32 bits, and we assume that's probably an access address. So we sit around waiting for packets and we collect these candidate access addresses. Once we've seen one enough times, we assume, yeah, that's probably a valid access address. And then we just move on to just filtering packets based on that. Great, so now we have lots of candidate packets with access address. We're gonna have a lot of false positives from that. So we move on to finding the CRC in it. The way a CRC is calculated in Bluetooth Low Energy is using this LFSR here. You fill it with a CRC in it, and then you feed the data packet into the LFSR here, XOR it with the output of the LFSR, and then feed it back in. And you just do that with all the bits of the packet, and the value that's inside this LFSR at the end is the CRC. Well, we have the value that's inside this packet at the end because we just sniffed it off the wire. We have the value of the data packets, or the bits of the data packet, because we sniffed those off the wire. What if we turn around the arrows and run it backwards? Well, if you do that, it turns out you can recover the CRC in it. And that's a really neat trick that Dominic Spill first wrote about back in 2007. So again, we just do this a couple times, collect some candidate CRC inits, and once we've seen the same value enough times, we assume that's a CRC init. Cool, so now we have two of our four values. Time slot length is really easy. There are 37 channels, so that means that when the connection hops between channels, it starts on one channel, it hops, and it's going to visit all 37 channels before it comes back to the first channel that we started on. So what we do is we just sit on a data channel and calculate how long it takes for a packet to appear twice on that data channel. If we divide that by 37, that gives us the time slot length because it had to visit 37 channels before coming back. So that one's easy. Then the hop increment. This one actually is a little bit more complicated, and it turns out it's a bunch of math, and I'm not going to get into that. So if you want to find out more about this, talk to me after the talk. But we have a reliable way for determining that. So cool. We have all the four values we need to follow a connection. That's neat. Sorry, I need to get my notes here. So yeah, we can follow connections that are already established, and the Ubertooth is the only device on the market that can do this, aside from like a $20,000 piece of test equipment. So yeah, that's nice. So here's the status of what's been implemented. We can sniff new connections, we can sniff already established connections, and we can also jam connections. This is all in Git right now. If you just git clone our repository, you have this. Also, if you're running Gentoo, you can just emerge it right now, which is really nice. I want to thank Zero Chaos for that. I'd also like to mention that everything I've talked about so far is implemented in firmware, which is going to be interesting later when I talk about some future work. So let's do a demo. Right now, I'm wearing a heart rate monitor on my chest, as I showed you at the beginning of the talk. I know, bold. I really hope it's a passive device. But so this window right here is Ubertooth, and this is sniffing the advertising packets. You can see them kind of scrolling by slowly there. And I'm going to establish a connection. I can't really see that. I'm going to establish a connection right now, and you should see the heart rate in the top right start changing in just a second. And is it? No, demos never work. Oh, did it? There we go. Is it at 116? Oh my god. I don't feel that nervous.
Lay off the bacon.
So, oh, I just killed my connection there. But it was totally working, and if we scroll up a little bit, there we go. This right here is a heart rate packet. And you should be able, I think that 74 right there corresponds, that's hex 74, that corresponds to my heart rate. So there you go. Sniffing connections totally works. Thank you. So now let's get to the really interesting part. Let's talk about security. So we've established that anyone with an Ubertooth can sniff your connections. So what do we do about it? The obvious answer is, let's use encryption. And the good news is the spec does define encryption. The bad news is it's not very good. So before you can establish an encrypted channel, you have to agree on a key. And the key exchange is actually where things start falling apart for Bluetooth low energy. This is all based around 128-bit AES, so all the keys here are 128-bit AES keys. The first key, so key exchange is actually a somewhat complicated process. It goes in three stages. I won't get into all the details of it, but the first key that you use is called the temporary key. And the pairing mode that you use with the device determines what temporary key you use. And there are three defined in the spec. Just works, six-digit PIN, and out-of-band key exchange. So never trust anything called just works. They use a temporary key of zero. So yeah, that's no good. The six-digit PIN, it just uses a number between one and a million. You just enter six digits on your device. And so a million values is not that hard to brute force. I don't have any numbers yet because we haven't actually run it, but yeah, suffice it to say that this is practically useless. And finally, out of band, that's the only pairing mechanism that provides meaningful security, but that's actually kind of cumbersome because it means you have to have, like, you have to be able to plug in your device to your computer or something to exchange a key. So as a practical matter, I only really expect to see just works and six-digit PIN out there on most devices. So yeah. So none of these is Diffie-Hellman. Diffie-Hellman would mitigate most of these attacks. I don't know why they didn't just use it. Your guess is as good as mine. So here's the scenario. I'll tell you, it's great to talk about how it's totally broken, but let's actually walk through how exactly it's broken. Alice has a brand new Bluetooth low energy device, and she pairs with it. Meanwhile, Eve is sitting by with an Ubertooth, watching all the packets that go by. And let's just say Eve stores all the packets. They're encrypted, but she can store the encrypted versions. If Alice is using just works or the six-digit PIN, Eve recovers the temporary key like that. Using the temporary key and the pairing data that Eve has been observing and storing, Eve recovers the short-term key. With the short-term key and the key exchange data that Eve's been observing, Eve recovers the long-term key. The long-term key is the session key. Game over. Not exactly. So each connection uses a nonce. So Eve has, and that's exchanged when the connection's set up. So Eve actually kind of has to witness the connection setup in order to recover this value. Also, the long-term key is only exchanged once, and it can be used for many connections. So you only have to securely pair with your device once, and then thereafter you can establish a secure connection with it without re-exchanging a key. So that, like, you know, puts a damper on all our plans. Why are we even having this talk? Well, that brings us to active attacks, which are, you can detect them more easily, but, you know, they're still out there. So how do you witness a connection setup that's already happened? You can't, but you can force someone to reconnect by jamming their connection. And we have code in the repo for doing just that. So that's solved. And what about connections that are using a pre-shared long-term key? It turns out the spec has provisions for a slave to say, I don't know anything about that long-term key, in case the slave is, for instance, lost its memory or something. So in this case, you just watch the pairing data go by, and at the right moment, inject the reject message saying, I don't know anything about that long-term key. And that should cause the master to renegotiate a long-term key with the slave. I don't actually have any devices that do encryption, so I can't verify that one. But yeah, there are no devices out there that support encryption, which is also kind of weird. So yeah, Bluetooth low energy, security pretty much busted. And here's the thing. This is from the spec. None of the pairing methods provide protection against a passive eavesdropper. The Bluetooth special interest group knew about this, and they still published the spec with these broken pairing mechanisms. They go on to say, a future version of this specification will include Diffie-Hellman public key exchanges that will provide passive eavesdropper protection. The devices are out there, guys. Why didn't you get it right the first time? This is unconscionable, in my opinion, because this gives people the worst kind of security, a false sense of security, just like WEP. And it's just wrong. But why should I care about low energy security anyway? It's just heart monitors and stuff, right? Well, remember those other devices I talked about? Like the wireless door lock? Or the insulin pump? I'm sure a lot of you guys already saw this article. Last week, Barnaby Jack demonstrated an attack against a pacemaker where, you know, he put 830 volts across the terminals where your heart should be, which enables you to murder somebody from 30 feet away using nothing but a laptop. Insulin pump? Anybody? Yeah. So, the takeaway from this is that low energy security is compromised by design. Don't rely on it. If you need to, use out-of-band pairing. It's the only mechanism that provides any passive eavesdropping support. Alternatively, you can bring your own encryption, but that might be cumbersome and, it's a little bit funky. They really should have just gotten it right the first time. So, some of the future work that we're working on here, we'd like to provide Kismet and Wireshark integration. I'm already talking to Dragorn from Kismet about doing that. So fire up Kismet, and there's a list of all the low energy connections that are going on around you. I'd love to demonstrate the encryption attacks. If anybody has a device that supports encryption, I'd love to see it. So since all this is implemented on the dongle or on the firmware, we can actually do a lot more now. Like, we can implement a Bluetooth master on the dongle, and you could totally do full man in the middle between a master and another slave device. So that's a little bit more, it gives you more opportunities to play with things than just injecting packets. You can actually have entire false streams of data going to your master device. Or I'd also like to implement the slave on the dongle so we could clone a device. So I really am Jack's heart monitor. I totally am. I promise you, your heart rate is 150 beats per minute. Now, the other thing is that we could, this picture here is of Dominic Spill's Ubertooth. He soldered an SD card to the GPIO pins, and you add a battery to that, you implement the SD spec on the Ubertooth, and toss it in the bushes next to somebody who has a wireless door lock, for instance. That'd be kind of cool. There's one other thing I'd like to mention. A lot of the stuff I talked about depends on the channel map using all 37 channels. There are some technical hurdles to get over if it's not using all 37 channels. However, again, I have not seen a device that doesn't use all 37 data channels, so that's that. So anyway, I'd just like to really say, give a huge, huge, epic thanks to Mike Osman and Dominic Spill. Without those guys, this wouldn't be possible. So I think those guys deserve their own round of applause, personally. Please. And I'd also like to give some thanks to Mike Kershaw, Dragorn of Kismet, the Ubertooth team on Freenode. If you're interested at all in Ubertooth, you should join. They're pretty cool guys in there. The Blues team, as far as I know, the Blues is the only platform other than iPhone 4S that has support for really anything Bluetooth low energy related. So we're in an odd time where a Linux laptop is the next best device to use after an iPhone. That's cool. I'd also like to thank the Bluetooth Special Interest Group, because I did rail on them kind of hard there, but they're, I really like to thank them for making the spec publicly available and for not giving us trouble about doing this. And finally, of course, I'd like to thank Toorcon for giving me this opportunity to speak to you guys. So, that said, thank you very much. Any questions?
With the Bluetooth 4 spec, is it the same, basically?
So the question was, is this the same as the Bluetooth 4 spec? And the answer is that Bluetooth Low Energy is just one of the things defined in the Bluetooth 4 spec. It also defines some extensions to the older Bluetooth modulation modes. So if you see something that says Bluetooth 4 compatible, I don't know if that necessarily means it has low energy support. What you need to look for is the little badge with a Bluetooth logo that says Smart Ready or Bluetooth Smart.
So what's the difference between 4 and it went from 1 to 2 and right to 4?
There's 1, 2, 2.1, 3. There's just a lot of spec revisions. They all introduce some different like alternate modes. Like there's a mode where you can use 802.11 with Bluetooth and stuff. Those were all defined in specs prior to version 4. Version 4 is the first spec that introduces this new low energy mode. Any other questions?
How long do you need to send the jamming signals before everything will disconnect?
It's usually just two or three channel hops, and that's depending on the parameters of the connection. Typically that's like less than half a second. If you're hopping fast enough, it could be like within just a few dozens of milliseconds. Any other questions?
Without jamming, how often do you see like your heart monitor go through a new advertising connection phase?
So the question was, without jamming, how frequently does my heart monitor reconnect? And the answer is that I've left my heart monitor connected for like hours and it never had to reconnect. So on the other hand, if you just, you know, if the channel was noisy enough and there were just a couple CRC errors, I think it would probably drop the connection. So, but as a practical matter, it's designed to stay connected indefinitely. Anything else? Going once. All right, thank you very much.